I'm Chris Tomato Harfenist.
I'm Alex Skolnick. We're right here in New York City, and today we have...
We have a New Yorker.
We have a real New Yorker. We have somebody from a New York institution.
Yeah.
You're best known as the guitarist for Twisted Sister. I'm excited. We're not gonna take it. No!
Totally. Mr. JJ fucking French.
You know him from Twisted Sister.
Yeah.
He's been a manager of groups like Seven Dust.
Yeah, and Sound Aversion. Here he is.
Let's bring him in.
Mr. JJ French.
French.
Yeah! Danny, you want to go?
Yeah! Welcome. Welcome to our abode.
And our metal crew.
These are the kids.
Hey, well, Chris, I'll do anything for you, buddy.
Thank you.
Yeah, a long time friend.
We went through a lot together.
And we've had a very meaningful 5 minutes in the hallway.
Absolutely. Really cool.
But you guys, we were just saying you guys have played on a...
Bills together.
We've crossed paths.
Yes.
Believe it or not, our Testament and Twisted Sister end up on the same festivals.
Yeah, on the summer tour circuit in Europe.
Yeah.
We wind up on the summer tour circuit. That's kind of interesting because we play the kind of... 80s kind of thing, and then we play the more death metal, black metal ones, and then we run across Helloween and Cradle of Filth and Hatebreed and Children of Bodom. You know, the whole
yeah,
run.
Yeah, that's the craziest thing about Twisted Sister is they'll headline like Wacken.
Yeah, and then Sweden Rock. You know, like Yes opened up for us at Sweden Rock, one of the most surreal experiences of my life.
Yes opened up
because I went to see Yes in high school. You know, so here they are opening for us, and I'm thinking they must feel like crap that they're opening for us, and I feel embarrassed that they're opening up for us. You know, and I'm really honestly feeling like these guys must be feeling terrible because if I'm them, I'm feeling embarrassed that they're opening up for us. And I said to the promoter, you know, what's up? He goes, well, you guys are like much more pop. You know, here I went. Okay, that's wonderful, but that's still surreal because in high school, when I'm 16, 17 years old, I'm looking up at bands that Yes album comes out, you know, the Fragile.
Fragile.
You know, it was an important record for me. So to be, I mean, Yes, we've been in the business for many, many years, and so I should be immune to this hero worship thing, right? I should be enough for it.
Right.
But you never fail to respect the people who have given you the inspiration, right? I mean,
always.
AC/DC... You know, we know those guys. They used to be on the same record label. I have a photo of me and Brian Johnson and Angus. I have them by the headlock. It looks like I'm taking like two jockeys to the Kentucky Derby. Like little guys, right? And because we were on the same label. And but yet Twisted cut its teeth on AC/DC and Judas Priest songs, especially.
What AC/DC song? The
band comes out. Oh, well, it's Long Way to the Top.
Long Way to the Top.
Yeah, okay. I mean, if I hear that song, by the way, at any time,
you play,
in any
place,
my body goes into like a tense mode because, I mean, I got 3 minutes to get on stage. I mean, I could be in a car at someone's house. I hear that song and I freak out.
It's like,
it's
my God.
Intro
song. Got to get ready.
For 35 years.
The whole song.
So the minute the bagpipes coming, I'm going, oh, my God, I'm already
Which Metallica did. Didn't they do that?
For a while.
Didn't they start doing that?
They did, but we've been using it longer than anybody.
Right.
But anyway, AC/DC is kind of like.
You got to sue them.
This band is so monumental to me. When I go to see shows, which is not that often, but when I go see AC/DC, I will stand for 2.5 hours. I will not be one of these like, yeah, you know, whatever, because I wouldn't do that to them. They're like, they're the best. So I went, I took my girlfriend who wasn't a big AC/DC fan. I said, you're standing for 2.5 hours. Yeah. I'm telling you now, we got great seats, got it from the promoter. We are standing. And we're paying homage to that band because that band makes me feel like I'm 17 again. And there are very few bands that do that now.
Yeah.
Right.
Because we do it. You know, when you do this professionally for as many years, and I just celebrated my 40th year with Twisted Sister. So this is our 40th anniversary.
Wow.
40 years, and may I add, 9,000 performances. Okay, let me add that.
Wow.
9,000 performances. It's kind of crazy. You know, every performance, every night we played. Not 9,000 nights, I'm going to be clear. In the early days, we were doing 5 shows a day. So you would do, you know, when the bar scene was in the early days for me, the copy band bar scene, you did a 9 to 9:40, 10 to 10:40, 11 to 12, 1, 2. That you ended up at 2:40 in the morning. And you're 20 years old, and this is what you did for a living. You know, you did like 5 40-minute sets, but we were a show band. We were Glitter, so we changed our clothes all the time. So it was like a fresh performance every time.
Right.
And so the first year or two, we were doing 5 sets a night. This by 1975, 76, we were doing 4 1-hours, then 3 1-hours a night. Then as the scene progressed over the years, it got down to 2 1-hours or 2 1.5-hour shows.
And there'd be like 1,000 people.
Well,
like,
the bar scene, which you guys will never, unfortunately,
it's not
know.
Like a bar. It's not
because
like
the drinking age is 18. If the drinking age is 18, that means 15-year-olds get in with phony proof. And back in those days, phony proof was you made it in shop class. I mean, it wasn't like you needed digital anything. It was like all, you know, Mr. Cleary's class. You just made phony proof. So the bars that we played in, that cover bands, I mean bands that played cover songs, the bars held up to 5,000 people. So when you made your way through the circuit, starting out in the small little pubs and working your way to the big clubs, by the time you got to the big clubs, you were a concert attraction. So after 10 years, we had played, out of that 9,000 shows, we played about 6,500 to 7,000 in the bars. We worked 250 to 300 nights a year for 10 years. But in those days, you could do it, play other people's material, learn your craft, make so much money that you buy a truck and all that crazy stuff. I mean, some band recently, kids come up to me all the time, they go, hey man, you know, give me some advice or whatever. My first reaction is, wow, I never had advice from anybody. So I kind of just, when I joined the band and became Twisted Sister, I didn't know what was going on. I kind of just kind of closed my eyes and jumped and figured I'll get my ass kicked and learn every lesson, but I'll get my ass kicked. I knew I was going to get my ass kicked, and I got it kicked.
Right.
It's a lesson to you. Don't ever be afraid to get your ass kicked, but just every time you learn a lesson, don't make the same mistake twice. So I tell people, get a new way to get your ass kicked, but not make the same mistake twice. So bands would come up to me, they go, give me advice. And I go, well, okay, let me think now. When I started, gas was 19 cents a gallon, okay? Richard Nixon was president. Watergate hadn't happened yet. Gas, hotel rooms were $19.95 a night. Truck rental was $25 a week. The house that we rented as a band was $300 a month. The phone bill was 10 bucks a month.
You guys had the same house?
Yeah, electric bill was Mendoza? 10 bucks a month. No, this is way before Mark. This is the original lineup. This was the original lineup. But Mark, you know, that original lineup.
You guys should watch Mark Mendoza.
Yeah, the guys who you know is the band, that band's been together for 38 years, which is impressive. But the original lineup guys you never heard of. And it's another thing I can get into about drugs and alcohol, because I hate them both, and they've destroyed everything that I ever think about, they wreck. And so my job was to fire everybody who did drugs and alcohol, which is what I did. I fired them all until we found the band. But anyway, getting to the numbers. You know, so gas is 19 cents a gallon, hotel rooms are $19.95 a night, truck rental is $25 a week, you can rent a house at 300 bucks a month, your electric bill was 10 bucks, your phone bill was 10 bucks, you can make $150 a night playing in a bar 6 nights a week, make 900 bucks, and have enough money left over to pay your rent, pay your bills, rehearse, right, follow your dreams, and maybe make demo tapes to become rock stars. This was my playing field. Like, this was the life I looked at when I was 20. I was 20, I went, that's the playing field. I get it. Okay, I understand it. Let's make $150 a night, 6 nights a week playing in the bars. You could come up with a business plan. Now let's look at the business plan.
The landscape has changed.
The landscape. So I call it observing your playing field. What's your playing field now? Gas is $5 a gallon. Hotel rooms are $300 a night. Truck rental is $500 a week. Drinking age is 21. The amount of clubs is 10% of what they used to be. There's no place to play. If you can play, you have to pay to play, right? And then there's no record industry. So I'm thinking, how am I processing this? Like, if I'm 20, if I'm you guys, I'm thinking, okay, wait a minute here. Where's the dream? Where's the angle? Where's the road? Where's
actually,
the
where
is the pathway?
That to, because sound
I, because if because if I was you, if I'm you, I'm thinking, okay, I guess this is what I'm thinking. I'm 16, 17, 18, 19. I got a lot of energy. I believe I'm going to make it. I don't care. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care what JJ tells me. I'm going to make it. Fuck him and everybody else, my parents, everyone else. I'm going to put my band together. And we're going to play, but I can't really get a record deal because there really are no record labels, so I'll make my own CDs and give them away because no one pays for music anyway, which is fine,
right?
I'll go on social media, I'll build up a following, hopefully they'll come to the shows, I'll make money live, I'll sell merchandise, and hopefully maybe a song I write will wind up on Grey's Anatomy or some TV show or movie or you know, something will happen that's magic, or I'll get on one of these things and then some band will love me and they'll take me out on tour and I may make it as a live act, because I don't see the pathway right now. And I'm not telling you there isn't a pathway. What I'm saying is, when I was your age, there was a pathway that was clear for me to understand it, and I followed it. I really was, there's a business plan. You know, there's a phrase, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You've heard that phrase. There's one word missing from that phrase, money. I love it. It's, you know, it's sex, drugs, rock and roll, money. I was the guy who went, where's the money? Where's the money going? Where's it coming from? How am I living? You know, it's enough that you're partying, but how do we sustain ourselves as a band? So you have to come up with an answer. And I know you will, because the scene is not going to die. Music will not die. But the way to get there from your road and my road are two very different roads.
Yeah.
Very well said. Yeah.
And it took you 10 years even to get to the point where...
We could get it at that time.
When there was a path.
For us particularly, we had a very rocky start because no one really wanted to sign my band. And I will tell you, for all the books you read, Motley, or you read books on the Beatles and the Stones, all these bands, the difference in them and us was they all got a deal relatively quick. I mean, the Beatles, you know, 3 years into the Beatles, even though they worked at the Hamburg Club, you know, the clubs in Hamburg and learned their trade, 3 years after they started, they got their record. They started in 1960. They went through a couple of lineup changes that most people don't realize. Stuart Sutcliffe died. The original bass player died of a brain tumor.
Pete Best.
Right. Pete Best was thrown out. Ringo comes in, whatever. And every band has these kinds of stories. Yeah. But they went from basically a basement to a record deal in like 3 years. We went from a basement to a record deal in 10 years. Now, in that 10-year period of time, the question is, well, how do you keep it going? How do you sustain yourself? Because here's what happens. It's one thing to be 18, 19 years old and say to your parents, hey, man, I'm going to be in a band. It's another thing to tell that to them when you're 29 and not making money, and your girlfriend wants you to get a job and get a shower because, you know, she's sick of being with your disgusting ass. And, you know, like, how come you're not making money? So we were making money, luckily, and we were showing a clear progression because the clubs were getting bigger and bigger, and we were able to make demos and then go out to a club. Listen, if you had the luxury of making demos in the afternoon, even if you sent them to a record label and said no, but go on stage that night and play to 2,000 screaming people, that's not so bad, right? I mean, that's kind of like a dream, right? That's kind of a cool thing. Okay, well, we got turned down. Big deal. I'm playing to 2,000 people. Well, that sustained us for 10 years because our following was massive. But after a while, everything gets old. It doesn't matter anymore. If you don't show progression, it doesn't matter what happens because someone else may look at you and go, I wish I could be that. But you're looking at you going, I am that, and I'm bored. I am that, and this isn't helping me because I'm not going anywhere. So life is always greener when you're looking at someone else. I have found that every single band I've ever talked to, every single one of them, I think that they think that their life is great. Man, there's stories of how much they hate what they are or who they are or how they are. Yeah. It just shows that, you know, don't ever assume that someone else's story is like some sort of like wonderful story. Because I'm telling you, it's not.
Good advice for younger bands, because, like, you know, you, like, he was talking about how the performance is like the tip of the iceberg that you see, and there's all sorts of history under it. You know, most people, they go to a show, you see a band, you figure, oh, well, they're, you know, they're rich and whatever, and they just started a band and got signed. But, you know, like, when you hear something like that, those guys suffered for like 10 years trying to get a deal and not having money and being, you know, being on the road and nobody liking them. You know, it's like anybody that hears a real story like that is either gonna just quit or gonna get super fired up. And I think it fired all of us up.
Another thing I think is that stuck with me from what he said was, you know, back in his day, to follow your path as a musician, it was a very clean-cut set of ways that you go about doing that, and of course that's changed now. And he was saying himself, like, if he were a young musician working today, he wouldn't know what to do exactly just because it's changed so much. And I think it's, you know, both terrifying and inspiring to hear that from a guy like JJ, and you just, I don't know, it makes me want to just keep going and doing whatever I can, take any opportunity I can to play music, because that's what I like to do.
Thank you guys, man. Thank you guys.
Two guitar legends, JJ, Alex.
Yeah, I'm sure we'll run across each other again on tour.
At festivals.
Right, at festivals.
Yeah,
if not this year, next year.
You'll headline over us
and
everybody.
Whatever. We'll have fun.
Yeah.
We'll have fun taking you out. No, motherfucker.
Yeah.
No.
I'm clear.
No. Actually, we just say, take us out. Dude, please.
After some of those stories.